Exodus 11. And the Lord said unto Moses, Yet will I bring one plague more upon Pharaoh and upon Egypt. Afterwards he will let you go hence. When he shall let you go, he shall surely thrust you out hence altogether. Speak now in the ears of the people, and let every man borrow of his neighbor, and every woman of her neighbor, jewels of silver and jewels of gold. And the Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians. Moreover, the man Moses was very great in the land of Egypt, in the sight of Pharaoh's servants, and in the sight of the people. And Moses said, Thus saith the Lord, About midnight will I go out into the midst of Egypt, and all the firstborn of the land of Egypt shall die, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sitteth upon his throne, even unto the firstborn of the maidservant that is behind the mill, and all the firstborn of beasts. And there shall be a great cry throughout all the land of Egypt, such as there was none like it, nor shall be like it any more. But against any of the children of Israel shall not a dog move his tongue, against man or beast, that ye may know how that the Lord doth put a difference between the Egyptians and Israel. And all these thy servants shall come down unto thee, and bow down themselves unto me, saying, Get thee out. And all the people that follow thee, and after that I will go out. And he went out from Pharaoh in a great anger. And the Lord said unto Moses, Pharaoh shall not hearken unto you, that my wonders may be multiplied in the land of Egypt. And Moses and Aaron did all these wonders before Pharaoh, and the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, so that he would not let the children of Israel go out of his hand. Early on in this chapter, it says that the Hebrews are to borrow jewels of gold and silver and other things from the Egyptians. And of course, obviously that wouldn't be very honest of God to ask them to borrow something with the idea that they're going to leave and go back and obviously never give it back. So this is another situation where we're looking at the translation. The Hebrew word is, and I'm not sure I'm pronouncing it even close right, but it would be in English, S-H-A-A-L, Sheal. And what it means is to make a simple request or demand or require of the people you ask for something. Now, considering that the Hebrews had been unpaid slaves for at least a couple of hundred years for the Egyptians, asking for some payment for that would have been honest and acceptable. It also says that Moses was great in the sight of the people and in the eyesight of the servants. And I suspect that after all of these plagues, all of the people in Egypt, who were the main sufferers, not the Pharaoh probably didn't even go hungry, they would have recognized that Moses had tried his very best to see to it that these people suffered as little as possible. The first plagues were merely inconvenience. It was only when the Pharaoh was totally ignorant, totally recalcitrant, totally unwilling to let the people go, that there started to be any loss. And so that was part of the problem, was that was it. The Pharaoh wouldn't let them go. Now it says God said he hardened his heart. We know because we know that isn't how it goes. We know that God never does anything to anybody to harden their heart so they won't do right things. That is Satan's job. That's what he does. He does that to try to destroy individuals, tries that to try to destroy God's plan. That was what he did in the Garden of Eden. That is what he has done all along. That's his job. As far as he's concerned, that's what he likes to do. And the point of Satan causing Pharaoh to feel hardness of his heart was simply to cause suffering amongst the people of Egypt. Now, the reason God doesn't do it is that one of the principal reasons of earth life here, the whole reason why in Revelation it talks about a war in heaven, was so that we would have the free agency, the right to choose what we would do, the right to make decisions of our own here on this earth. And having made those decisions, then to have the opportunity to be blessed or to have problems because of the decisions we made. But it obviously isn't going to be fair to us or to anybody else. If God hardens our heart, we make a decision and other people suffer. That is totally unfair. And if you have a kind, wise, loving Heavenly Father, He is fair to everybody. He is not arbitrary. He does not do stupid things. He does not cause people to feel hurt or bad because of something He does. Everything He does is the same kind of thing that a wise, loving Heavenly Father would do for His children, because that's what He is to us. We are His children. He is a wise, loving Heavenly Father, and nothing that He does will in any way, shape, or form be for any harm to us. Now, there is a symbolism here between Satan, who wouldn't let the people go, who wouldn't let the people live righteously, who had them enslaved, and Pharaoh. Pharaoh was a type of, an example of, arbitrary force in keeping people in slavery. Just as Satan is arbitrary force keeping people in slavery through addictions, drugs, sin, all kinds of things. And just as with the death of the firstborn of Egypt was the cause of setting the people, Hebrew people, free, so the death of the firstborn of God, Jesus, is the cause of setting all of us free from Satan's grasp and from physical death. Everything that happens in the Old and New Testament is a type and a shadow and an example, if you look at it in those in inspired eyes, we hope, of that kind of thing. Everything teaches people about Christ and the example that He set, and how you can look in your life as Joseph looked in his life and saw that, yeah, his brother sold him into slavery, but that made it possible for him to be there ahead of them so that he could preserve their lives. He was, his name in Egyptian meant savior. Interesting. So Joseph was a type of savior to his family. Just as we as leaders, presiding officers in families, parents, are supposed to be saviors for our children. Just as we're supposed to be giving service in our communities, just as we're supposed to be examples of righteousness, these are the kinds of things that we need to learn and do. And this is one of the things that we learn from the trials that the children of Israel had and the Hebrews had and the Egyptians had. You've got two choices here. Follow the Lord and things go well. Fight against the Lord and there are problems.